निरंजन।
थैंक यू मिस्टर विजय शंकर एंड थैंक यू एवरीबडी ऑन द कॉल। इट्स अ ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर मी टू बी स्पीकिंग टू सच एन एलीट ऑडियंस। लाइक मिस्टर विजय शंकर सेड, लॉट यू हैव डिफरेंट बैकग्राउंड्स एंड डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ एक्सपीरियंसेस एमिनेंट इन योर ओन एरियाज। Just a quick disclaimer, this group is for data privacy, today you will not hear too much about data privacy. My session, like Mr. Vijay Shankar also kind of alluded, is more from a practitioner's perspective, from a perspective of an executive who has gone through this COVID impact, what happened and how CIOs are reacting, what I am seeing with some of my customers and what I am hearing from the market and on and so forth. So I thought I will bring in a 360 degree view of what is the COVID impact on different kind of businesses. So that's what I will be focusing on. Very quickly about myself. Mr. Vijay Shankar said, I have been with the IT industry for about 26-27 years now. 25 of those have been with Infosys doing all kind of roles, delivery, sales, consulting, pre-sales, operations and so on and so forth, grown through the chain. In my role, I work as a vice president and head of delivery. I am part of the software quality engineering and testing business of Infosys. We are more than $1 billion business, and almost a third of that rolls up under me. Verticals, industry verticals is what I am responsible for. I interact with clients from energy, utilities, communications, services, retail, logistics, CPG, and so on and so forth. So that's the remit of what I do at Infosys, managing the software quality engineering and testing business for our clients across these verticals, right? Also had good experience in leading some large cost optimization programs for the unit and driving organizational change management. So very important in this kind of a context, and also the representative from a risk council on the corporate risk council, I represent the business unit. So. And this was one of the biggest risks we could have ever seen, right? So interest areas, digital transformation is something I'm keenly following. New trends like IoT, 5G, and so on and so forth. Very keen follower of people practices, change management, and the whole cultural transformation of an organization. So with that, I will very quickly get into the topic for today. So as all of us know, COVID was a black swan event. Nobody would have really predicted COVID, right? A black swan event, as most of you would be aware, is an unpredictable event. Doesn't exist in your risk management strategies. Something which is a blind spot comes and hits you, and basically after that, all you can do is recover. Right, so black swan events are rare, don't happen all the time, but the impact is extremely severe, and which is what we have seen in the COVID situation. Businesses just could not factor it into their risk management strategy. There is no way we could have even thought about it, that something like this will come and hit us, and we definitely were not ready, right? Very simple example, and you take any business, there are obviously trade-offs on what are your investments. Very simple things like, do I give laptops to everybody in the company, whether it's a client organization or a service provider? These questions will come up, and you do a trade-off, some are desktops, some are laptops, and suddenly this kind of a situation hits you. How do you now transition, right? Because you don't have enough laptops. That's a big blind spot in your strategy. You never thought that you will ever get into a situation where everybody will have to migrate into a work from home kind of a situation. So it was a big impact to us. When I look at business verticals that across the board, almost every vertical got hit. Nobody was really insulated from this COVID impact, right? Starting with the frontline guys, the retail guys were the biggest hit. People, obviously, as soon as COVID hit, nobody wanted to go to any stores. Stores had to be shut down. Several of the retailers in US have actually filed for Chapter 11, which is bankruptcy, essentially, right? Just over a period of a month, all of this happened, right? Suddenly, stores shut down, revenues went down. Costs became too much. They had to lay off people, shut down stores, and some of them even went down the bankrupt. Same thing happened with your transportation and hospitality. Pretty much every other airline is in a big mess right now. Some of them have filed for bankruptcy. Hotels are closing. Businesses are pretty much going out of this thing. And these are large organizations we are talking about, right? Big chains. Each of them, when you look at from a CIO perspective, is a CIO organization on its own, right? Huge amount of IT spend every year. Hence, you know, these are big target customers for a lot of the who are servicing them. Similarly, manufacturing pretty much factories, etc., shut down. Logistics. Right? I mean, what do you deliver when there is nothing to deliver? A lot of the logistics bandwidth we know went into supplying medical equipment, PPEs, and so they had to really re-strategize their business to make up for whatever losses they had in rest of their business. Very, very not so intuitive businesses like utilities. For example, given that utilities had a very big share of enterprise business and enterprises are shutting down, the usage of electricity and gas across the US, across the globe, went down drastically. And with that, utilities also started getting into trouble. Not so much, obviously, as much as retail, because the end consumer, the home consumer spend increased and there's some bit of balancing, but utilities also took a big beating because enterprise businesses pretty much shut down. Oil and gas, with the oil prices dipping to, at least for a day, they were down to even negative. People were buying off the shelves. And now they are around $18, which is a rock bottom. And it is not a sustainable model for oil and gas companies. Several of them are really cutting on costs, right? They are running into big issues. Telecom providers, while we may think that, you know, a lot of us working from home is going to help them, enterprise business is their big money spinner, right? So, and that again took a big beating. Banks are yet not there. Banks are still spending, but it is catching up slowly. Maybe another quarter or so, banks also probably will get hit, right? So overall, the business across the world, the economy across the world has got hit. We know that. I wanted to just give some specifics around what kind of impact on various industry verticals we have seen. Some of them, like retail, have really come down drastically, even 25-30% business impact to service providers who are providing business to retailers. On the other hand, the likes of utilities or telcos are probably more like, you know, 3-5% depending on what is your exposure. Similar telcos, while they did not get hit, some of the telcos are also into media and entertainment. So, for example, Comcast is a very big cable company in US. They also have Universal Studios. They have their entertainment parks and so on and so forth. All of that is shut down, right? So that's a big hole in their business. Hence, that is again impacting them. So COVID has impacted most of the business verticals across the world. And so what do they do, right? What are the CIO priorities in this kind of a situation? How does that change in the new world? That is what I will try to focus on. A lot of this is experiential and also from the market analysts and so on and so forth. So I will share my experiences. So the first and foremost priority is business resilience. What does resilience as a dictionary word, the meaning of resilience is the capacity to recover quickly. Essentially something has hit you. You did not know that this is going to hit you, but that's fine. How quickly can you recover from these difficulties? How tough are you? How toughly built are you from design so that you recover from these difficulties and bounce back? Right, so that's the key of being a resilient organization. Now, a lot of organizations could recover, a lot could not, right? The guys who were resilient were able to pick it up and come back very quickly and bounce back. But several organizations, even today, are struggling with getting back to the normal. And what does normal mean? Are you really, so if you are providing a service to your end customer or you are providing to a customer's customer, right? So are you providing service to a business or to the end customer? Are you available? First of all, is the service available? In a lot of cases, what happened, say legacy businesses, they did not even have online channels, right? And so if they don't have stores, they don't have anything. And essentially the service itself is not available. The second thing is, if the service is available, is it performing at the same levels of the service levels are being met, or are you becoming really slow in your responses to customer and you're not able to service every possible request and so on and so forth? So the performance bit actually took a beating on the service levels, right? Are you able to scale it up from where you were pre-COVID to the post-COVID, quickly scale it up and come back to the new normal? Is it a secure setup? Are you agile? Agile in terms of re-architecting your business, re-strategizing. For example, like I said, in the logistics space, some of the big logistics guys have told us that they had to very quickly change their business model to cater to things like the healthcare equipment, the PPEs and so on and so forth, because there was nothing else to deliver, right? And that was not their core business, but they had to quickly change over. Similarly, in banks, suddenly governments have kind of introduced some these COVID-related loans, right? So those were some things that the banks and the banking systems were not ready for. They had to very quickly turn it around in their systems and service the larger population, right? Finally, is the customer experience really at the same levels that, you know, it was pre-COVID, right? So that's what is a resilient organization. Obviously, there are two parts to it. Operational resilience, which is the here and now immediate priority, right? If I take some examples from what happened with some of the service providers or even the businesses, as soon as this hit us, the first thing was, so we were all delivering work. A lot of our work gets delivered globally as well as from India, right? And this is true for a lot of the service providers, right? We have clients in US, we have clients in Europe, we have clients in Australia, New Zealand, so on and so forth. A large part of the population works out of India offices. The rest of it, almost 25-30% works out of the global offices. And we had to be available. The service has to be available, which means that, you know, today office gets shut down. So suddenly what happened one fine day, government said Pune is closed, right? So what do you do? I mean, you have to shift everybody to work from home. And within a period of week, 2 weeks, we have, as I can say, as an industry, we have migrated almost 90-95% of the people from existing setup of campuses, buildings, etc., work from home model. What did that mean? Very simple stuff. As I was saying, everybody did not have desktops or laptops, right? So we had to figure out who has laptops, who doesn't have laptops, do they have personal laptops? Can we pick up the customer laptop and customer desktop and ship it to people's homes? We actually shipped a lot of desktops and laptops to people's homes. Some people were in fact in native places. We have made sure that those laptops and desktops shipped to their place. Now, the desktops, for example, customer desktops, for no good reason, obviously not have a wireless adapter. Very simple thing, right? Why will you have a wireless adapter when you are inside the campus? You will not. But at home, there is only a wireless connection. You work. So now we had to supply wireless adapters to all these guys, right? And wireless adapter was not easily available in the market. It was it had suddenly become those rare items, right? And so those kind of things, we had to supply UPSs to people because power outage was a big thing in some of these areas. And so with all that, it was a humongous task for us to actually get just the infrastructure, simple laptops and desktops moved out. We had to get permission from customers, right? A lot of our customers did a dry run. In fact, we did a dry run. We moved some 10-15% of our people first to work from home. As soon as the COVID thing started, we started moving as well. Almost every other customer, we did a dry run. We got their approvals from their cyber security, from the procurement organization. We had all kind of approvals because a lot of customers, in fact, the master services agreement doesn't have work from home. Very easy to work from home, and that's on a case-to-case basis. And as a norm, most of the customer agreements don't have work from home built in. So we had to actually go back and renegotiate with the customer vendor management. The service levels could be kept at the same levels, and so on. So many other things happened, right? One of our customers, their call centers, they had to actually migrate to remote working. Just call centers is all production data, and it's all, you know, customer facing data. They had to take some hard calls and move people into remote working. And they were able to migrate. And today, majority of people servicing businesses, close to 95%, I can say, are already working from home. Different companies are at different levels of compliance. Certain businesses like banks, they still are not okay, right? Because there is sensitive data and so on and so forth. In certain cases, we had to have a skeletal workforce still work out of our campuses with permissions and all that. So a lot of that had been done. So worked out with the government agencies and you know, worked with the various parts of the business, whether it is employees, partners, or IT organizations, support functions. Your sales guys, because now sales guys are not able to obviously go in front of the customers. It's all calls. And we had to establish new ways of working. Now today, everything is online, right? We had to establish the Cisco WebEx platform. We are building our own platform as well. So a lot of that change happened over a very short period, 2-3 weeks. The entire business was migrated from office to essentially work from home, right? So operational resilience is all about coming back very quickly so that your customers don't feel the pinch. And certain organizations could make that happen, certain organizations could not. And even today, certain organizations are obviously struggling. It comes back to what I, organizational resilience. which is the longer term. Are you resilient by design? Across all your products and services, you have to relook at all your policies and processes. You have to relook at your infrastructure. Very simple things. When we did the VPN, bandwidth obviously was not sufficient. And performance issues. We had to tweak the networks and we had to add bandwidth and so on and so forth. So are you designed for those kind of situations? Is the question. Are your applications going to scale up, right? Is cybersecurity taken care, right? We know one of the big service providers in India got hit by a ransomware, right? Huge amount of penalties. Some of the large customers, Honda recently has in the news, you would have seen Honda has been hit by a cybersecurity incident, ransomware. They are investigating. But those are the kind of incidents we are really worried about now. And how do we strengthen the cybersecurity setup, right? Is your supply chain the right thing, right? Or do you need to revisit your supply chain? Because a lot of these smaller providers that you had, you probably are not invested enough in terms of being able to scale up and respond to these kind of situations. So is the organizational resilience built in? Are you resilient by design? How do you bring in some of these things into your longer term organizational policies and processes is the thing that you have to look at. For example, we are now also working on, now that if this is the new normal, how do you make sure that people are really comfortable working at home, right? So those are the kind of things from a policies perspective. Broadband policies have to be revisited. We never had the need to have everybody get broadband, right? So what kind of cost will that mean to the organization? And you know, how do you set a criteria and so on and so forth? So those policies have to be revisited. So those are the kind of things that as a CIO, priority number one, business resilience is absolute immediate priority. Almost every business CIO has been losing sleep, I would say, getting calls from their CEOs. They've become the most important person in the organization right now. You know, suddenly in the limelight because of the COVID situation, transition the business into the new normal and keeping the lights on, right? So so the business resilience is absolutely priority number one for most CIOs. The second is the increased digital adoption. There is suddenly this awakening, I would say. Well, digital adoption has been picking up for a long time now. But a lot of the CIOs have realized that this kind of a situation, if they don't have a digital channel, they are pretty much in soup. And even today, if they don't have a digital channel, then their organization is just, you know, really going to suffer in the market, right? So they need to respond very quickly. It has suddenly become one of the biggest items on their agenda. For multiple reasons. Number one is health and safety of employees, right? Health and safety of employees is suddenly a big focus area. Every organization is looking at ways to protect their employees when they are on the campus, in their buildings. They are bringing in a lot of digital technology, starting with simple things like when I am entering the campus, how I have a digital app on my phone. I have to register saying that today I will come into the campus and this is my declaration saying that I am fine. There is nothing wrong with me, right? I don't have any of the symptoms of the COVID and so on and so forth. When I enter the campus, there is an elevated temperature check. Then throughout the campus or buildings, you will have cameras that are monitoring every person, taking the images, looking at social distancing. There are AI algorithms in the background which will crunch that data and tell you whether social distancing is being maintained, if people are wearing masks, and so on and so forth. And so many such new solutions are being developed for health and safety of the employees. Suddenly, CIOs have started spending a lot of money on this. And just imagine in a retail store, retail organization with thousands of stores, the amount of spend, it will be in multi-million dollars, right? Including all the hardware, software, everything. It's a huge business opportunity for a lot of the providers, as well as it is something that is highest priority right now on a CIO's mind. The second thing is obviously the customer, right? The customer experience has to be completely reimagined. Now, if you're thinking of a store, I'll give you an example. One of the large telcos in US, telecom companies, their stores, they are completely reimagining the customer experience because they want to make sure that the stores are safe for their customers to come in. They have got rid of a lot of the furniture. Now it is all designed for social distancing. So the customer experience is being redesigned. They are bringing in a lot of the social distancing technologies using AI and all that data I spoke about in the health and safety of employees. Suppose a customer is coming into a store. The store... So you first of all, online, you will know whether certain things are available, not available. When you are going to the store, you will be able to send a message to the store. The store will acknowledge once you are somewhere in the vicinity of the store and tell you whether it is safe, not safe, all of that. When you enter, there are AR technologies that will help you navigate the store. The most of the sales reps will be actually remote. That's what they are thinking. Sales reps will help you navigate through AR technologies. Augmented reality will actually help you go through the customer catalog, the product catalog, and select what you want. You can feel the product and all that in the store. However, there may be no people, right? So the people will be remote. They will come on video. They will help you navigate the AR technology and help you go through the whole product setup, right? Now, through all of this, AR technologies are being adopted for multiple such things, not just for store experience is one example. The other could be sales and service. For servicing, now the sales and services people are sending messages to the customers to download certain AR instructions. Customer can go through those instructions on their own and have a conference call or a Zoom call or whatever with the services person. That person will give the instructions. The customer will have the AR in front of them and they can do the service themselves. Right? So that's the kind of evolution that is happening of the services sector to support the products that you have sold to the customer. Similarly, there is a lot of data, obviously, that is getting collected, whether it is about health or about the customer experience and so on and so forth. So there is a lot of spend that is coming towards the data analytics and machine learning areas as well. Machine learning, as I said, is also an integral part of the solutions that are coming into the health and safety as well as the customer experience journey that is being reimagined. Now, the last thing, obviously, that's also happening while cloud adoption was already on the rise. Now that nobody is on-prem, there is no need for you to be on the campus, etc., etc. The cloud adoption is actually moving faster. And also because a lot of people want to move into their digital journey, they want to be able to reach their customers much faster. They want to be able to deploy new products and roll out new products very quickly. Customers are asking for new stuff in this crisis situation. The companies have to also very quickly adopt and roll out. Like I said, banks, the COVID loans, or it is the logistic companies, they have to rejig their applications to be able to deliver the PPE equipment or so on and so forth. The cloud adoption will help. And so CIOs are actually moving much faster on the whole cloud adoption journey. So these are broadly from a digital adoption perspective, the whole journey is getting accelerated a lot faster than what it would have been pre-COVID. Post-COVID, the opportunity has immensely increased on the digital adoption area. The third and extremely important again is optimizing operations. It is today in the COVID world, post-COVID world, everybody is under a cash crunch. Economies are obviously under pressure. Businesses, as I went through, have taken a big beating. Obviously, you need to save cash. So what do? You really focus on only critical initiatives, right? For example, one of the utility customers we work with in US, they were modernizing their grid. Grid modernization would have given them the capability to better engage with their customer, also look at intelligent routing, etc., which today doesn't exist in the electricity network. But today they are putting all that on hold, because those are not critical initiatives, right? And when you have only so much money, you will focus only on critical business imperatives, regulatory compliance issues, and so on and so forth, which absolutely have to be done. Those are the things that are getting done. Rest of them are being put on the back burner, coming back to only what makes sense with the amount of money that they have right now. So everybody is trying to refocus on critical initiatives. The second thing that is obviously happening is with this whole work from home, a lot of businesses are realizing that the real estate they carry is not really needed, right? Some of our customers in Australia, they have decided to give out all the buildings. Most of the buildings that they have were on lease. They have actually given up the lease, since most of the employees and any vendor partners will not come into those buildings. There is no need for businesses to really hold on to those real estate. So that real estate is really being now given off, and that's a big cost saving again for them from an operational efficiency perspective. Third thing obviously is extreme automation from a cost imperative perspective, as well as from a building a contactless organization perspective, right? So today the biggest issue with COVID is the contact. So as long as you can build a contactless organization, social distancing obviously one thing, but then if you can replace people with bots and so on and so forth, which has suddenly become a very big priority, because if bots can do the job and they can do it remotely, maybe people can still monitor it, but then a lot of the work should hopefully get replaced with bots. Easier said than done, but that is another area. Extreme automation is something that people are looking at. Leaner operating models, which essentially comes down to, do I really need all of this infrastructure, all these people? Can I get the same job done with lesser number of people? How do I retain my high performers, etc., etc.? Those are the other discussions going on. Overall, from a cost perspective, how can I be much leaner? Can I go back to basics and question every process in the organization using the lean methodology, whether I really need this process or can I just cut it out and make it simple, right? So entire back on the table, every organization is relooking at their business processes as well as their operating processes. The entire operating model is being actually relooked at. And the last thing obviously, which I also mentioned earlier, is the supply chain consolidation. Particularly businesses, from a CIO perspective, typically have 4, 5, 6 vendors or even more in some cases. Can I consolidate this and give it to 1 or 2 vendors, and can I get huge amount of discounts? While it may add some bit of risks, it's a perceived risk in terms of cutting down the vendors, right? There is also a perception that you lose control and so on and so forth, but that's back on the table as well, right? Because you want to consolidate, you want to cut the lab, you have too many vendors, then you will have so many overheads as well, which you don't necessarily need for the business. Can we consolidate from say 8-10 vendors to say 2-3 strategic vendors and give the business to them? So a lot of that also is back on the table. Overall, optimizing operations is all about how do I maintain my profitability in this tough situation and still stay competitive and relevant in the marketplace, right? So that's the overall theme that CIOs have been tasked with. And so obviously, very tough job. And the last, but not the least, how do I reimagine my employees' experience, right? Health and safety is one part of the story. Workplace transformation is the other. Now, I did mention that businesses are giving up all the buildings that they have, but then what happens if people want to come into offices? So obviously they are planning for say 40-50% capacity. Now, when you have only 40-50% capacity, how do you manage that? So you have to put some infrastructure around that. You will build some applications that will help you run it like a hotel, right? So every time an employee has to come into the campus or into the building, they have to block the space. They have to tell somebody that, you know what, today I will come into office, go into some application, block the relevant space. Again, in there, the spaces that will be available to you will be such that the impact, in case some one person gets infected also, there will be isolations. It's not like you can go and sit anywhere. So there are certain areas only where you can go and sit. And so in case somebody really gets infected, only a small part of the campus is not available, right? So that's one bit. And the second bit of workplace transformation is all about how do I make it better for my employees to work from home, whether it is from a policies perspective, it is from ergonomics perspective. How do I help them with better infrastructure, but maybe better bandwidth, maybe better chairs and all that, right? So how do you look at the broader spectrum of things that will help employees improve their productivity? As such, there is a big debate on productivity is going up or not. So metrics for that also have to be arrived at. How do you really measure productivity when somebody is not in office? And some customers are actually saying, your guys have become extremely productive. I am seeing even code check-ins happen late night at 1 a.m. and all that. Of course, that's probably more suited to the younger generation. Their lifestyle, they will take breaks. They'll work through the day. There is no time limit. They'll keep working. In some sense, there are pros and cons. A lot of people have put in a lot of effort over the last 3 months. Working hours have increased. Productivity also, at least perceived productivity, has certainly increased. Right now, the third important thing is obviously reskilling for the new normal. This is from multiple dimensions. One is from a technology dimension. As I said, the big shift to digital is happening, but not all of your workforce is ready for digital. So how do you reskill them in this new normal? That too in an online infrastructure. Are you even equipped? Do you have the right partners with the online universities, or you have your own setup? You have your own training platforms, content, and so on and so forth. So that's a big area of investment. How do you retrain? The other thing is from a motivation perspective, how do you also run some soft skill programs and, you know, mental health programs? How do you engage your employees, right? How do you keep them motivated is the other aspect of this whole thing. And finally, the fourth one, which is also emerging, is why not then have a gig economy, right? Gig economy is like Uber. It is on demand. People can be brought in and they do the job pretty much freelancing. They get paid and then they are off the system, right? So a lot of companies are exploring that as well. How do I work with the gig economy? There are players in the market who have already started. There are at least from a software testing perspective, there are companies who will hire people for 2 weeks, different demographics, different kind of age groups, different languages across the world. They will bring you all kind of experiences and help you test your products, different products, different customer experience. And that kind of is the other thing that is emerging. So overall, these are the three or four key priorities from a CIO perspective. The last thing is what I would want to submit is work from home is the new normal. This is a new normal world where most people will work from home. Campuses will be pretty much skeletal. You will probably have at some point in time, you know, today it's probably 90, before COVID it was 95% of people in office and 5% at home. Post COVID, right now it is 5% in office and 95% in home. Maybe it will come back to 40-60 is the hope that a lot of the businesses have, because obviously there are risks. At a CXO level, everybody is worried, right? Cybersecurity, the attacks are real, and the hackers are more and more becoming dangerous every day. This is the opportunity for them. During this opportunity window, they are trying to maximize the impact. So CXOs are absolutely worried. Middle managers are happy because the work is getting done. There's absolutely no discontinuity. Very quickly, businesses and the CIOs have been able to move their people into work from home situations, their own employees as well as the vendor partners. So middle managers are okay because they are getting the job done. Employees are absolutely very happy. A survey actually said that one key reason employees are quoting for not coming to office is that they don't need to wear formal pants. So that's a big indication of where they are on this, and they are extremely happy. So that's where the jury is still out there, and my belief it will probably settle down 40-60 at some point in time, and we have to obviously live with this new normal. So that's broadly what I wanted to kind of share with all of you. I hope it was useful. And if we have some time, Mr. Vijay Shankar, we can do few question and answers.
Now we will definitely have questions. I'm sure there will be a lot of questions. You have covered quite a wide area of activity. In fact, like particularly for small businesses, the CEOs and themselves will be finding out that there are so many issues they have to focus on. At the same time, I'm always excited about the new opportunities which some of which you have highlighted. I'm sure many of our members will have questions. So now the floor is open for questioning. You please unmute and then ask your question or raise your hand so that I can unmute you, whoever wants to ask a question. Okay.
Two people who have raised their hands, it says.
Rajesh.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for making us aware about the COVID impact in transport, retail, and the hospitality industry. But then post COVID also, when as you mentioned about maybe 40-60% of work from home, those culture, if it has been widely accepted globally, then also this industry will be impacted, because like transport, whatever the number of people will be moving around for their business purpose, that will also go down. Airlines also may be impacted because of ICT infrastructure. So how one can look at it, whether this will be a sustainable business model, even though of course new software and all what we are in the industry, because I work for Bureau Veritas, and you are our customer where we are doing your InfoSec audit and all. So I I'm just trying to understand, like, maybe is it called as a temporary situation where entire world will be facing, and maybe by after when the medicine will be available, and then once again the business may start from 2021?
Yeah, great question, Mr. Rajesh. As I said, today nobody wants to come back. 5% of the employees are really coming back to office because they're scared, right? And a lot of people, if you look at the India situation, a lot of people are in remote areas. And that will probably continue to be the new normal, right? People can actually work from anywhere. If it can happen last 3 months, 5% of the people in office, 95% working from home, then why not, right? Because the big question the employees are asking is, why not? I mean, I am comfortable doing it here. You can't really pull everybody and bring them to office. Industry-wide, businesses are nudging people, encouraging people to come back, but they are not really coming back right now. But once COVID is done, at least hopefully 30-40% of the people will come back. From an employee morale perspective, it certainly helps if people want to work from home and we can make that happen. Certainly, it's a good thing. It's a good thing for the environment. You are saving so much fuel and so much pollution is getting cut down. Travel going down will help the environment, so it's a good thing. From a perspective of operating costs for companies, it will certainly come down, because you don't need to run so many campuses, so many buildings don't need to be maintained, you don't need to pay the lease, right? Operating costs should come down substantially. And so with that, it is good for the business as well. As long as the customer risk is taken care, which is where the cybersecurity is the big blind spot everybody is focused on. As long as we can cover for that, I think we are good. And this will probably stay as the new normal. The generation of kids that are coming out of college, they are only used to this kind of stuff anyway. That is a new workforce that is entering the industry, right? Given that perspective, this is kind of here to stay. Companies who will adopt this will thrive. Companies who will resist it will probably find it very tough to attract employees. Good employees would probably come if you are going with this thing and taking care, balancing between your employee and the customer.
Yeah, Ramesh has got a question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Mr. Niranjan, first of all, thank you very much. Excellent and neatly presented material, which is the need of the hour. My quick question is, which you touched upon at the previous question, last bullet. What are the challenges that industry is going to really face it, and how we are ready when we are talking about the freshers getting into this new norm? Because the existing crowd, as we know, yeah, no problem. They understand. Some of them might not have the laptops and so on. But now working from home is going to be the new norm. How? What are the challenges, and how are we ready to cope up this? Yeah.
Thanks, Mr. Ramesh. Very relevant question. Challenges are multifold. First of all, this generation, obviously the new generation, the millennial generation, they have a very different kind of lifestyle, right? I think we did touch upon some of this in one of the previous presentations, I do remember. The millennial generation asks our a free work environment at their will, at their time, right? You cannot bind them into a 9-to-5 kind of a model, which we were already finding it very tough. Honestly, when we were working pre-COVID in a 9-to-5 situation, people would walk out at 5, right? But today, that same generation is stretching beyond ours. The way, we have to adapt. That is the first thing. The ways of working are very different. They'll probably start somewhere late. They'll work for 2-3 hours, take a break, then again work for 2-3 hours, and they'll keep going till 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the night, which is good for our customers. I'm looking at it from an India perspective. The India based employees will work late nights, and they will certainly deliver to the commitments, because now we have given them the freedom. What we are also saying is, given what we have given them the freedom, they are also being very responsible, right? So while all this while they were asking it, for various reasons it was not happening as an industry. It's a big mind shift, right? Mindset has changed as an industry, as a, you know, set of management, business managers who have been managing the business. There is a big shift. COVID made it happen. Now, the same thing people have been asking for quite some time. We were not able to get all the MSAs in place, etc., etc., to make it happen. Suddenly, now it's all happening, right? Because you have to keep the business up and running. Now, these guys are also equally responsible. They are taking the responsibility, whether it is from a cybersecurity perspective or it is from the deliverables to the customer perspective, right? And there again, there is a mixed bag. There are obviously bad apples in every this thing. They are broadly very responsible. And we have seen productivity actually go up. But customers have said that productivity has gone up. Now, there are obviously the bad apples who need to be handled. A lot of guys who are not able to deliver, they have not gone the extra way to even, for example, somebody doesn't have a laptop or even a mobile to do training. We have offered online training. A lot of the companies are offering. A lot of these people don't come forward to take it because it's almost a paid holiday right now, right, for them. So there is an attitude issue there. And in those cases, obviously, these are being handled in a very harsh manner as well. Look at their upbringing, the new generation. And I can talk from an IT perspective. They are trained on almost everything that we talk about, whether it is the machine learning or it is data sciences or latest programming languages and so on and so forth. By the time they get to your workforce, their expectations are very high. So managing their expectations itself is a big challenge with this workforce. And that will only become worse as the time goes by. And these digital transformations, these shifts, is something that those guys will like. Right, because these are the kind of technologies that they really want to work on. And as long as companies are able to get opportunities that will give them a kick, they will stay with you and you will also be able to attract them. Obviously, the reskilling is a very big piece in the whole puzzle. You have to invest in reskilling your employees. At the same time, your customers also should realize the worth of those reskilled employees, and so that you are able to balance your cost and what revenues you make, right? Your investments have to be kind of brought back. The return on the investment has to be there. So you have to reskill them on all the new digital skills, whether it is AI or machine learning, and different companies have different kind of programs. For example, at Infosys, we have built our own learning platform, and we have content that our training organization has developed, and a lot of our guys go through those certifications, and the reskilling program is really a success. A lot of these guys actually want to go through it, and post the reskilling, obviously, then the next challenge is, can we give them that kind of work? So we have to make sure we are able to get those kind of projects and engage them, because the mundane stuff doesn't really interest them, right? So those are some of the challenges, and we will have to work through it. The other issue, obviously, with this remote working is you don't talk to them face to face. You have to have regular conversations with them, video chats, right? We, for example, just yesterday, we did a rewards and recognition across all our development centers. We did a virtual rewards and recognition, right? Over the Cisco WebEx platform. People like that. I mean, people want to hear a lot more things from leadership during the crisis situation, because a lot of them are also looking for directions. What do I do during this situation? I don't have a project. What training do you think I should go through? What are the channels for me to get that training and so on and so forth. So there is a lot of over communication that has to be done during this crisis situation. And in some ways, this generation requires that as well. So you have to over communicate. You have to become their friend. Right? You have to talk to them in their parlance, in their language. That is when they will probably become part and parcel of your team. I hope.
Great, sir. Thank you. Great.
Yeah. Dr. Rakesh?
Yes, I've got few observations. I'll not say questions because questions means that time will overshoot. Thank you for the very informative presentation. Now, there are two things which when work from home comes, work from home and work for home. When person is at home, he also work for home also. And it gives flexibility. But it's at the same time, it clashes with the common meeting time of the organization. And that happens in the organization when everyone is there for 8 hours, 9 hours. So there he is detached from home. But in this situation, the person is working from home and work for home. Apart from that, other issue is in a city like Mumbai, the homes are small. Many times, even one or two bedroom, both husband and wife are working from home. Children also do their online education. So home becomes a cramp. It is either one or two bedroom. Then it becomes more noise than convenience. Many people are now fed up from work from home and they want to go back to the office as soon as it is allowed. That I have seen in certain cases. And the culture to work together in the office is changing. People are used to personal chemistry in the office, meeting, talking personal, solving each other's problem. That is now becoming individualistic. And lot of work need to be done in the change management regarding culture. Motivational challenges also exist. That is what my question or comments, whatever you want to take, are about this work from home.
No, absolutely, Dr. Rakesh, very valid comments. In fact, that's what I was alluding to when I said that the ergonomics piece is something that as an industry we have to address, right? You will be surprised. Recently, one of my employees actually, we were encouraging people to come back post the lockdown, right? Lockdown, once it opens up, why don't you guys come back to the campus? You can have face-to-face conversations and all that. And these are people living in some of these metros, whether it is Bangalore or some people in Pune and so on and so forth. They actually said, you know what, I want to go back to my native place. And for similar reasons that you said, a lot of them were staying in PGs, they're sharing, our youngsters, right? So they're sharing the PG accommodation. So obviously, you know, three of them working in the same room, taking calls, everything is becoming tough. But, and from a cost perspective also, it makes more sense for them to really work from somewhere in their native place where the space is much bigger. As long as they have a broadband, they can work, right? So they don't necessarily want to come back. They in fact want to go further away from the metros. So the cost of living actually goes down and they are still able to access broadband, have a much larger place. Their parents are there. They don't need to pay any rent. It's a big cost saving, right? So the lifestyle itself is going to change drastically. The rentals may come down in metros. People will not be taking any PGs on rent. PGs are all going to be empty. They're already that situation, right? So that's the other trend that is happening. And of course, the motivation piece, as you rightly said, that is something we have to keep addressing through soft skill training, through over communication. We have to keep talking to the employees and making sure they are aligned to the organizational objective. Because in all this, the organization culture is a very key aspect, right? And that actually comes when you are together, you are mentoring with this whole remote working. That's going to be the other big challenge. How do we make sure that the organization's culture is still maintained and they don't become individuals and they're still a collective part of the organization?
Okay, I will come to Kodan Raman in a while. Mr. Kush Srivastava has a question. Srivastava?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Srinivasan. This is Kush Srivastava. I am a group business continuity manager for Emirates National Oil Group. Okay, it's a conglomerate of about 45 group companies across the oil and gas supply chain. My question is that now it is not actually related to work from home. It is something to do with, you see, Corona or COVID-19 has had an impact that today pandemic risk is a coexisting risk, and it will remain so for the next 2 to 3 years or 5 years until we find a good and a permanent and effective solution. Now, in the light of the earlier, all my contracts and agreements were having condition that a pandemic is a condition covered under force majeure. Okay. Now, in the new normal, what I should be doing?
Niranjan, you have.
So I got the question, Mr. Kush. Not that I have a straight answer, but my only suggestion would be, again, I mean, every business needs to have a business continuity plan. We can't obviously, you know, yeah, force majeure is a good clause to have in the contract. But then if this is going to happen too often, then we should be even ready for recovery. And so one perspective I can give you is this whole, the way we transitioned to work from home, similar transition has to happen to work from office, and both these have to work hand in hand. When situation is good, people should be able to seamlessly come back to office, work from offices, and at least 40 to 50% of your population should be able to come back. And when, suppose, there is a second wave, you should be able to switch your operating model seamlessly within a day, 2 days. And that is where you have to think through every part of your business process and look at what else needs to be done to make that switch seamless. And obviously, you have to do some pilots, which is what at least we are trying to do in certain accounts. We are already trying, you know, how do you switch and how do you keep rotating people, because the same set of people cannot be working from office all the time.
Yes.
You have to make sure that you have a rotation. Some people, maybe every 2 weeks, part of the team works from office. So that, you know, it is switching every 2 weeks. It is a seamless switching happening. So if that is working, then if and when the second wave hits, we should be able to pretty quickly switch over.
Just one more point we should be considering is that, you see, first and foremost thing is that as an organization or as a service provider, okay, I should be having a very structured pandemic business continuity plan where I have segregated the teams into number of people or into number of teams which is equal to the for effective delivery. One. Secondly, you see, in a normal business continuity situation, you have a situation where you are doing your delivery from either from the primary site and alternate site, where I am doing the continuing the prioritized activities within the recovery time objectives. Should there be an outage in the primary or a site which warrants continuation of office or work from alternate site. Whereas in the pandemic, your number of delivery centers is equal to number of people working from home. The dilemma is that, you see, while all of us are working from home, or that is the new normal, okay, as a vendor, what I should be doing to support such a company or such a, I'm just taking an example that Infosys uses a vendor XYZ, okay. Earlier, vendor XYZ was supporting the campus in a particular place. Now, at this point of time, a vendor has to be supporting a staff which is located across the city. Now, in such a situation, in my earlier situation, business continuity, okay, I can say that pandemic, so sorry, I'm not covered. But today, as a vendor, as an owner of XYZ, if Infosys says that I need service at XYZ place within the city, I can't, as XYZ, I cannot refuse. The reason is that today, that is the reality, that my vendor is, my service point has multiplied. And that is the reason where I should be thinking of recognizing, you see, as XYZ, I would want to service, but I will not be able to service at the same terms and conditions and cost at which I am servicing at the head office. So I would assume that I can renegotiate where I need to have a better returns for myself as XYZ. And for that same matter, if Infosys wants a service delivery across the city instead of two or three places, obviously it will have to reconsider of taking on a vendor which is able to do it, has the technical capability and ability to honor the aspect of health and safety and technical prowess and the other aspects relating to the pandemic operation and pandemic continuity.
Yeah,
absolutely, Mr. Kush. I agree with your assessment. The business continuity plans now have to look at all of these aspects, right? It is from, like you said, the health and safety perspective or from the supply chain itself, we have to evaluate the various vendors on their capabilities to be able to deliver from wherever the employees are. And the client organizations also, in some ways, have to make that shift. Even today, we have clients telling us that, today, somebody is working from a certain location because, you know, it doesn't matter where you deliver the service from at this point in time, right? But right. How will you seamlessly transition that to my captive, which is, say, based in Bangalore, right? So these are questions that are real questions and we have to address it. And maybe that employee is today working somewhere in Trivandrum. The guy doesn't want to move to Bangalore. So what is your plan, right? So... And we will have to make sure that we have some good transition plans, good reskilling plans, right? At obviously the vendor's cost without really disrupting the business, right? At some point in time, if there is a customer objective to put some people into their captive, we should be able to transition that business pretty quickly. So there are a lot of these kind of issues that will come in and we will have to address it.
Thank you. Kodal Raman, you have...
Just one last bit, sorry.
I think, sir, question was, sir, yeah. I'll just take up my question, which is slightly kind of a thing where we have to come out of the IT. See, Indian economy is catered more by MSMEs, especially as far as goods manufacturing sectors are concerned, either in the larger sector or in the small sector. How this manufacturing industry have resilience? Is it possible or they will have to again struggle more and more as compared to the IT industry? That's my question, sir.
I don't claim to be an expert in manufacturing. That's my first disclaimer, right? If there is somebody on the call who has better expertise in manufacturing, can certainly answer.
This is Kush Srivastav. Can I take that?
Yes, please.
Yes, Kush, it is for you only. Come on.
Okay. You see, what is happening is, you see, first and foremost thing is that in the manufacturing sector, there is the concept of business continuity is quite a complex one. Primarily because if you want to have a proper business continuity for a manufacturing unit, okay, you need to have literally a equally capable plant or equally capable unit, which will mean that your investments get doubled in terms of the second unit, and your profits will become half because of the investment. Now, in the manufacturing sector, what the companies are doing are currently that, okay, they are doing the segregating the supply the production transaction life cycle into what is known as forward and backward integration. And in the forward and the backward integration, they are then getting into the aspect of in most of these industries, okay, you have common vendors who are servicing you as well as your competition. So what they are doing is that they are getting into strategic alliances which will ensure either with the competition or with the or with one of the vendors and suppliers to ensure that their core production transaction life cycle gets supported irrespective of the economic condition. But at the same part of time, in case if you're take an example, okay, let me do, I work for a oil and gas company. So take for example, if there is the supply chain disruption of sourcing the crude, now I cannot replace crude with anything else. So that means that is a risk which I have to take on, and I have to ensure that I have to multiply my sourcing of the crude from crude. I could take it locally, I could source it within UAE, I could import it, I could do a high C transaction. So it is a matter of how you want to, you see, the supply chain risk and the continuity aspect and the impact of pandemic, okay, is such that it is very typical to the manufacturing industry what it is doing. Now I'll give you one simple, I'll just take 5 more minutes.
No,
okay,
I think that has reached us. Your message has reached us. We do not require, because we are running out of time. That's what I feel.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, Kush. Of course, before we wind up, just a couple of questions are there on the chat box. I want one line answers from Mr. Niranjan. One is from Srinivas, who says that what will be the impact on the persons who are laid off? That is one. Second is, whether there will be slowdown in, this is from Malesh Reddy, whether there will be slowdown in job creations because of this 40-60 division. So these are the two things, layoff and then whether there is going to be job loss.
So on the first question, on the layoffs, absolutely, as at least right now, companies are going through a tough time and they are cutting costs and there are people being laid off. But the most important message for those people is that they need to reskill themselves, right? The areas of spend are changing. Companies are going to spend a lot more on adopting digital technologies towards health and safety, for customer experience, for employee experience, and so on and so forth. If you have digital skills, if you have gone through industry certifications, etc., you will be much more marketable. Cybersecurity itself is a very big area, right? Today in US, 10,000 odd jobs are open for cybersecurity. We don't get people, right? Because we don't have enough people who are certified and can actually do the role. So the big thing is it's a demand supply issue. there is a demand for digital technologies, there are not enough people. Whoever is reskilling themselves, absolutely, the market is hot.
Thank you. It will also apply for this reduction in jobs, job creations, I suppose. So it's a question of reskilling. Okay. Now, for the final conclusions from Mr. Kodandraman.
Yeah, thank you, sir. It's a great opportunity to give my vote of thanks to Sri Niranjan Srinivasan, who has taken us really, as the name says, 360 degree view he has given. I was really very happy because the talk was so well structured. He started with impact on businesses, verticals, and resilience. That's very, very important. They have to come back. May not be in the original form, may be in the changed form, but they must be able to perform better. And the way left now for the digital adaptations, optimizing our operations, our reskilling. It's really something remarkable talk today evening we had. We are benefited. Sir, on behalf of FDPPI and on my behalf, I sincerely thank you for all your efforts. May God bless you. Next, I congratulate and thank Mr. Vijay Shankar Na taking our time away for this Vidya Jnanavardhini. Really, my jnana has increased because I'm from a traditional school. I'm trying to graduate into the digital school. Still, I'm not able to transform myself. I remember the species which is very strong may not survive, which is weak also may not survive, but only which can adapt can survive. So I'm trying to become survive myself, to the reskill myself. And this is a great opportunity for me to learn from all these elders. I thank FDPPI. I thank all the listeners as on day, especially Kush Srivatsa, who could add more value. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Be safe. Be at home. Have a happy evening. I say good night. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.